let's not do that. That's
however you want to rip it. It's fine.
And let's play intro roulette.
Oh goodness.
Let's do.
Is that time? Things just ain't the same for young Jermaine. Still underrated, but far from underpaid. And though some problems did fade, the hunger stayed. These stomach rumbles could humble thunder. I'm still fueled by the ones that slumber, to stand out amongst the one-hit wonders. So when the dust settles and the sun is under the horizon, y'all should run the numbers. Who the want what with me? Heart is out, and I say that reluctantly, because it should go without saying, but y'all playing dumb.
Welcome to Films in Black and White, everybody.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
Brian, I love that that's your mouth horns. I love that you could have gone, bah, 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 and you just went, oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Well, that's
like Marcus's thing. I don't think I can do mouth horns. Like, we've already covered this when we talked about Brian. Nicki Minaj and like all the sounds she makes. I can't do that. So this is my version of that.
That's true. Yeah. Yeah. Mine would definitely be the like, brr, 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 like yeah. That would be mine if we did that.
I can't do that.
I don't know why those are my favorite ones, but that's what I'm doing. But enough of me talking. We have a very, very, very exciting episode for you all today. We have a fantastic guest waiting in the wings. You'll also notice that Marcus isn't here. And so I wanted to be publicly known because, you know, I felt like last couple episodes, he's been a little hard on me. So I'm going to be a little hard on him. The day we have a guest, where's Marcus? Does anybody know?
He's
Do we know
hard.
Where he is?
Hard, man.
Is he working hard or hardly working? Wow. Yeah, of course. You know something, Brian? Of course you would. Of course you'd stick up,
man. It was a solid dad joke, though. So it balances out.
Yeah, you. That's what I got. Brian, dubbed over 90s X-Men meme. How you doing, sir?
I'm doing great. I'm really hyped because we have guest Stephanie Williams coming to join us soon. So I'm hyped for that.
Outstanding. Yeah, it's a great day. It's a great, great day. You had your wife, Maggie. Happy birthday, Maggie.
Yes.
Day after March 3rd.
Yes.
Did she have a good birthday, Brian?
She had a great birthday. We took it easy, went out to lunch. We ordered Texas Roadhouse. She likes a good steak. And then, we watched Anyone But You by her request. So I got my rom-com fix, which was enjoyable.
Love that. I love that for you. So excited for you.
Oh, it's good times. How about yourself?
Good weekend. Went up and saw some North Dakota hockey, met some family up in Grand Forks, which was great. So did a little weekend away, stayed at an awesome Airbnb up there, which was really, really great. Nice. Checked out some of the local brewery scene, but all in all, it was great. This is enough of us rambling and chatting and killing time, hoping that Marcus will show up before we bring the guest in. We've tried. We've done all that we can at this point. and so here we are. We are going to introduce the one, the only, the fabulous Stephanie Williams. Stephanie Williams, welcome back to the pod, ma'am. How are you?
I am, well, I was going to say fantastic, but that's a lie. But I am good. I'm happy to be here. My weekend was not as enjoyable as you all. My petri dish that I like to call a son. He gave me whatever he had, and it took me out.
Yeah,
Thursday through yesterday, and honestly, a little bit today. But other than that, I got through the first episode of Avatar: The Last Airbender.
Oh, how are you?
Shout out
how
tonight, are you Phil. That? I don't know. I think it was a fever dream.
Fair enough. Meds will do that to you. I get it. Yeah.
I got through it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. It's good. Mm-hmm. I enjoyed it.
Yeah.
And I have no context for Avatar coming into this at all.
Oh.
Never watched the cartoon. I have thoroughly enjoyed this thus far.
So, Doug, just a quick question. Because I know you're fine. I'm asking the questions now, but
yes, I that's like fine. It.
So, like when we caught up with Aang and you saw that he was in the ice, did you wonder how long he had been in the ice? Or were you did you just assume it had been a long time?
I assumed someone would tell me eventually. So gotcha. I was just sort of patient, right? Like I was just like, we'll figure it out. Like I'm not worried. I don't need to know. And so I was just like, how long is it? You're right though. It is weird because it's a very quick jump and there's not a lot of explanation, but I was just like, I assume this will be some like non sequitur dialogue that we get at some point. And we did, which was great.
Okay.
Yes. The grandmother sounded just like the opening of the cartoon, which I thought was hilarious. Like,
that's awesome.
Yeah. Oh, wow. Okay. That was my only question because I thought it was just me. I was like, I know context wise that he's been in the ice for millennia, right? But anyone else watching this would be like, was he in there for 2 weeks? Was it a week? How long has it been?
It's a very good question. Yeah, that's a good point. I was not worried, but if I was someone who was like, well, how long has it been? You're right. That would have bugged me. And that would have bugged me a lot. So yeah.
All right.
I also love your little AKA Storm Stiff Mohawk.
Yeah.
That's a good one. Yes. That's a great one. So we are thrilled to have you here. Very excited that you're here. We just, if you wouldn't mind giving people a little bit of your like background, maybe what you've been working on lately. What are some things that you've been involved with in the past? Just catch our listeners up to speed on who you are, what you do. Tell us a little about yourself.
Okay, I'm going to try to give my Aang lore, basically. So I'm going to try to fill it in. Okay. Yeah. So I am Stephanie Williams, of course. Duh. I used to podcast. I think these fine gentlemen probably know me most for my X-Men memes is probably what caught your attention.
That's how I found
it. Yes. So I would do these memes on Twitter where I would take still shots from the X-Men animated 92 show and just do like funny goofy stuff with it. And then from there I wrote some things for like Sci-Fi Wire, Nerdist, really about comic books, sometimes about sci-fi stuff like the thing that we're going to talk about today.
Yeah.
And from there I started making my own web comics, teaming up with other artists to kind of bring these silly things to life that I would meme. And eventually I found myself writing professionally, which I'm still wondering how I was able to get in the door professionally with all the silly stuff, but like I'm here and been writing professionally since May 2021. So I do that. I also do some stuff for Amazon Prime. So if you're a fan of Invincible or The Boys, oh hey Marcus.
Welcome, Marcus.
You can check out some of my stuff that I have on their YouTube channel. So I talk about, again, The Boys, Invincible, comic book deep dives. And what am I doing now? I got a Spider-Man story going on right now on Marvel Infinity Comics. They finally let me write Peter Parker. It's a very unserious story. He is babysitting a influencer's little labradoodle. Because I'm on TikTok all the time. And I'm like, that's all I see. So I was like, okay, story inspiration. And then I have a Moon Girl and Devil Dinosaur graphic novel coming out April 2nd. So
that's sweet.
Oh, I'm excited.
I feel like I skipped some stuff, but here we are.
No, that's fine. I mean, the only one that you skipped that I was really excited about was you, because it was one of the first like physical comic books I ever bought was Nubia, Queen of the Amazons.
Oh my god, see, and how do I
let's back up. Pretty sure all three of us bought that because you told funny. I think you had a
that's
conversation
100% accurate
after we did a review and I can't remember which one, and you're like, anyway, I'm doing this, and we were all like, what? And
yeah,
that's
mine is currently signed and framed, Nubia number one signed and framed in my hallway right now.
Mine's right over there.
You know what, I will talk about Nubia because it was, she was one of my answers for Marcus's question. So I think there was a reason why I skipped her. Yes.
That's fair.
Oh,
okay.
I love that. Right.
Okay.
Love that.
And we'll just wait.
I'm so happy here.
Marcus, and that's why black people don't swim. How are you feeling, sir?
Yeah, this movie just confirmed every stereotype I was going to live by. So, you know what I mean? You see, the black man, he got up out of there quick. You know, I knew what type of movie this was.
We'll get to
the movie. I didn't like that at all, but that's
Maggie fine. Looked at me.
That's why I picked it, though.
Who chose this? And I was like, Stephanie chose the movie.
I picked it for that reason, Marcus, because you didn't have to be stressed in that way.
I knew it because I said that's why Steph picked this, because that's gonna be the whole plot of my whole review.
Yeah,
ain't no way that man, no way in hell that man sacrificed off a small crane. Anyway, what was the question?
How are you?
Oh, I'm good, man. It was a busy day. I was so happy to get here. I've been so excited for today. Black, live, and in living color. Happy Black History Year.
We have switched
Happy Women's
Black History Year here.
Month.
That's right. That's right. Yes. Good call. Good call. Marcus, you had a series of questions. I'm glad you made it because we didn't get to the questions.
Oh, good.
We have thoroughly prepped Stephanie on your questions.
Thank you.
But I'm going to let you lead the way because these were your babies. You came up with these. And so take it away, sir.
Thank you. I want to, usually we have a guest on and now Steph is family at this point, right? Because, you know, that's what it is. So, but I want people to be able to get to know you a little bit more. And so we're going to ask some questions just so they can get a little bit more familiar before we hop into our underwater review. And you answer them as loosely or as detailed as you would like. Stephanie Williams, doer of all things. Are you ready?
I am.
Okay. All right. This is the 5 W's, who, what, when, where, and why. All right. So question number one, who is your favorite character to write about?
It is Nubia. I think that is why I skipped her. Because originally, I don't think that was probably going to be my answer, but I keep coming back to her. And I miss writing her currently. And like, she is who set the stage for me, right? I was able to spread my wings and fly via Nubia. So I don't know. It's just something very cathartic about writing her too, because she's this Black woman who was like the literal keeper of hell, right? Keeping all of these bad things away. And then she gets shifted to a new role.
Beautiful.
And she has to deal with that. So showing her being kind of multifaceted in that way, that she can not just fight with her fists, but she can also be very thoughtful and pragmatic and be an actual queen. And what that looks like more so than Hippolyta in a lot of ways. So it's definitely Nubia. And the fact that she has not been put back on the shelf since I've stopped writing her, I think speaks volumes to a lot of the work that we put into that character. So Nubia, I will say, has been my fave to write so far.
That was a very beautiful answer. And your last comment is actually, you set the tone. When they come out with the Nubia movie at whatever point, you and your team's product and the story that you told and you developed, it will be the blueprint for that character moving forward, because that was the most I have ever heard of Nubia. It wasn't until you and your team got your hands on this character and actually developed something that felt real. As a Black man, usually you feel like, oh, maybe this character is not really related to me. I'd never felt like that at all in any edition that I read. So,
well, that means a lot.
Yeah. Nubia is that was really fly. So that was a great answer. Number two.
All right.
What is your favorite Beyonce song and why?
It is Green Light all day long. Oh. I go up for B-Day. To me, that is the cousin to Renaissance, which I also love a whole ton. Okay. But I love Green Light because when she starts going off with the goals at the end and yelling and everything else, I just live. Like, Green Light stayed on repeat while I was in college, and I'm probably aging myself there, but oh well. Wow. I love me some Green Light.
I love that. Okay, I love that. I was really interested to see what answer you was going to pull out, and it could have been anything.
I was happy and it gave me another Beyonce song to listen to, because I have not gone deep into her discography. So this is good for me. So yeah,
well,
I
can go somewhere. Doug, real quick. After you listen to that album and you listen to Green Light, go listen to Green Light with just the vocals, just listen to that and you will understand why.
Okay.
She's like that. Okay. Question number three. When did you feel like you really made it or was meant for this journey?
I thought I had that right away. You know what? Yes, I do. So it was while I was at I think Heroes Con back in 2022. This was my first time tabling at that con, like as a pro. And I'm there and like this family comes up to me, beautiful Black family, and they have like a little 8-year-old, and she is like looking, and she's like, and I had posters and stuff. She was like, hey, like, did you draw this? I'm like, I'm sorry, baby, I didn't, but I did write the character. She was like, wait, you can write? I was like, yeah, you can. So we had this little conversation, and she told me about all her stories and how she wants to be a comic book writer one day. And I don't know, like, I could just tell her face light, she just lit up because it finally clicked, like, oh, I see a older version of myself doing this. So like, I can totally do that. And I think when that moment happened, I was like, okay, so like, this is why I'm here, right? Sure to pay bills and to tell my stories and stuff, but it's also to inspire younger versions, little Black boys and little Black girls, and just anyone really that, hey, this wasn't my first career, so you can also do this too.
That's really cool. Beautiful.
Yeah. Incredible. That's one. Yeah, that's incredible. Wow.
Incredible. Look, look, this is a goddamn pro. All right. Where do you, but I forgot I was doing an interview. Where do you want to be in 5 years?
I would like to be in someone's writer's room, and more specifically in someone's writer's room for an animated show. I cannot stress that enough. I love animation down. Even if I didn't have an 8-year-old, I would still be watching Bluey. But like, I just feel like through him, children's media is just such a beautiful space. There's just so much you get to do, and you don't really have to worry about the other stuff, right? You just kind of tell your stories, tell them very straightforward, because kids are way smarter than we give them credit for. I just like silly stuff like We Baby Bears. Like, they had Ma, I mean, they had Young Ma the rapper on there voicing a bat. That's what is not to love about that, right?
Excellent. I didn't know that. That's amazing.
Yeah. But also Scavenger's Reign for the adult stuff. Like, I don't know. I just love animation, and probably that's why I love comics. So it's someone's writer's room.
I love that. Would you do a movie writer's room if you were given the opportunity, or is that really different? Yeah.
No, I absolutely would. I mean, honestly, Marcus, I am Miss Adaptable. So if you put me in the situation, I will figure it out. So if that came from that, that came first, then hey, I'll do it.
I love it. All right. Final question. Why do you write, or what is your why?
I write because I found that I can. And what I mean by that is, let me sound like Tokyo Tony, but
I like it.
Oh, that meme.
I love Steph so much.
That was awesome.
Yeah.
That was great.
Oh, but no, I write because it was the most freeing thing that could have ever happened to me. I was working a job that I hated, and it's not because I didn't love what I did, it's because I felt stuck. Where the position that I was in, my boss sucked. There was no way for me to move up. I couldn't go laterally, and writing was the most freeing thing that I could possibly do. And since writing has been the most freeing thing that I mean, just career-wise, I've been able to stay at home, which means I've been able to be like more active in my child's life than I probably would have been with the 9-to-5, right? And I don't, like, I've been able to travel to places that I didn't think that I would before. And it's just, I've met some amazing people. I've met you all. I don't think if I was online, like, memeing or whatever, I would have met you all. So writing has been the most freeing thing I've ever done. So that is why I continue to write, because I don't know where it's going to take me next.
That's really beautiful.
Thank you. That is the 5 W's with Stephanie Williams, doer of all things. If you want to know more, you can find Stephanie Williams on not that other app that we don't know.
I left it.
Yeah, rest in peace. But you can find Stephanie Williams, Google search, and you will fall in love with whatever it is your introduction to Stephanie Williams.
For sure.
Thank you.
Steph, I want to ask a follow-up.
Sure.
That is outside of the fives. So I think one thing that I'm that's right.
Your February is over.
You want to know something? You listened to the first 2 minutes of this podcast. I put your ass on blast.
He did it.
He did for not fucking being here when we have a guest in the house.
I couldn't do anything.
I know. It's okay. It's all right. You fight.
Because if it was Black History Month still, like, I could have been like, hey, and threw up the Uno card, but I couldn't even do anything.
He was waiting on this. When the 29th came, he was looking at the clock like 11:59. Yeah, it was because I called him a gracious white, Steph. I think that's why
you did call me a
great white hope.
I got a gracious white and great white hope in the same episode.
Yeah,
like it wasn't spaced out. Like within it was all 20 minutes right there.
The amount of people that have been calling you that, like casually.
Wait, was this? That's what I'm. Oh, it was
last week. A clip. It was last week.
I gotta listen because I still listen to you all. Like when I'm writing and stuff, and I need noise on in the back, and night noise on in the background. Like I just need to hear. Yeah, you know what I mean. But I guess okay.
I know exactly what you mean. It.
I do. Yep. Yeah.
My bad. Love
that. That means that there's people in Vermillion that are just calling me that.
Yes.
One, not knowing the reference. It means to call me that. And then they're like, hey, look, there goes the Great White Hope. And they're just like as I'm walking down the street.
That's what they said on January 6th, too.
That's alarming. It's alarming.
Marcus,
sorry, my bad. Go ahead, Doug. Ask the question.
Here's my question. I am always like one thing that I love to know more about is I love listening to comedians talk about process. Mm-hmm. Like how do they do their, you know, setup, punchline, that type of deal. What does your process from like a writing perspective, like what does that typically look like? Cause I think some folks think that like, they just sit down and they're struck by one of the muses and it just flows out of them. And that is not the case at all. Yeah. So what does your process look like when it comes to writing? Like are there you know certain habits that you have to do? Is it a little bit like a baseball player, like I gotta have the right socks or right chair in order to feel like I can do it? So tell us a little bit about the process for getting some of this stuff out of the head and onto the page.
So yeah, very much kind of like a baseball player. Like I have like writing hoodies. I'm wearing one right now with the Seattle Seahawks of all teams on it. I root for them, but it's a comfy sweatshirt, so yes, I have like specific socks I wear.
Okay.
So like it's like very specific. My nails have to also be done, I did not become a regular manicure girly until I started writing. I like to hear the acrylics on the
so
it's a little bit of ASMR too. Okay,
it is a little ASMR. Yeah. But like also like so before I used to just write whenever, like it was so chaotic and I'm like I cannot continue to survive this way. Mm-hmm. So last year I started listening to like different versions of lo-fi music, so some chill hop, even like some vaporwave lo-fi, if like for real lo-fi if I really needed to. Yes. But I would start my mornings off with that because it would kind of get me in like this relaxed state of mind, where I'm just like, okay, well, I'm pretending that I'm getting on the elevator to go to my 9-to-5, so like let me walk in. Yeah. And then I would like listen to that while I build out my scripts, because that's the other thing too. Comics are like kind of complicated to write because you have to keep in mind like your page turns. Now I don't have to think about it in such a like, ooh, I got to make sure that this is here. Like it's more of an innate thing. But before, like I had to make sure that, you know, the first page is the page here, 2 and 3. So my odds are always going to be my page turns. Okay. So what am I putting on that third, on that odd page in the last panel that is going to make the reader want to turn the page? Wow. So it's almost like having to do mini cliffhangers throughout the book.
Yeah.
Plus a cliffhanger at the end. But that's kind of how that goes. Also not writing off vibes, because you have a very bad time doing that. So actually sitting and doing my outlines, because sometimes you don't want to do that. Like you just want to go, but the outline is important. And as far as like ideas, they come. Sometimes I have a muse. Other times I'm just high and a thing strikes me and I'm just like, oh, I think that'll work. Yeah. And then other times it's sometimes just hammering away until something comes, because as I've been doing this longer, not every single job I do is a job that I'm just like, oh my God, this is a dream job. Sometimes it is literally just work, and that's okay. Yeah. It's okay that it's work. I have a client that needs me to write this thing and I need to hit on, you know, points 1 through 6. in my thing, yeah. And I do it. I did a mashup for Marvel and the NBA. They had very specific things that they needed me to do. It was really cool. But also, and I really did enjoy that, but like that was a job that I had to get done. Like there was some creative liberties, but like that was a thing where they were like, hey, you got to do this. We have to have it here. So yeah, but that's kind of it. But yeah, like I'm starting to realize that I get a little weird sometimes with the things that I need to, like the room has to be a certain temperature too. Yeah. So like it's,
That's the same thing like recording music. Like it's
I was just gonna say to you,
a lot of that is all the same thing. I gotta have the certain Crocs. My desk has to be at a certain height. Like it has to be, you know, it's not even like the music stuff. It's just more what is my drink? I gotta have a mint when I'm recording because like that's just a part of like my process. So that's dope.
Yeah, that's awesome. And my last question for you is so I think comic books definitely feel like they are pictures forward, story second. Not for the folks that read them, right? But like for someone who's like walking down, enters their random comic book store, they're going to be drawn to something maybe because what the visual is of and what visual stimulus is hitting in that sense. So what is the process for me? Because mainly I don't necessarily know, but also for those who also maybe not know, is it you put together your script, you put together the general flow that gets sent to an illustrator and then an inkist and then a colorer. And then from there, is that the process? And then you all kind of all review it together and say like, ooh, that's not necessarily what I was going for. What is that process for? How does a story then turn into a comic book on the other side?
So Doug, that actually varies sometimes. So with Marvel and DC, sometimes I'm lucky if I find out who the artist is before anything is drawn. Yeah.
That's really cool.
But yeah, and it can be a little bit of shuffle too, because if I, so in a perfect scenario, in ones that I've been able to be in, so I write out my script everything. So this is from like what should be in the panel, roughly, the dialogue, all of that. Now I'm not telling the artist like verbatim what to put, but enough directions so that they have creative leeway. But also if I need Nubia to be diving into, you know, Doom's doorway, then she needs to be diving into Doom's doorway. But then like I'll get the thumbnails back from the artist. So that's like their rough sketching. So kind of seeing, think of like principal photography or whatever for, so think of it that way. And then from there we can make tweaks. And then from there we'll do pencils. And sometimes I get to see those, and pencils is like your last time to be like, hey, I think I want this tweaked, or can we change this? And then once inks are done, the rule of thumb is to not change anything. In fact, if you need something changed, then you better change the dialogue, because asking an artist to go through and change, like that's kind of asinine to do that. But people do.
Good enough.
But that's it. And then like it goes to, so then once that happens, it goes to the colorist, and then sometimes before the letterer gets the script, I'll have an opportunity to look at the finished ink pages and look at how it lines up to my script and make any changes if I can. But it's not until the lettering pass, which is where either it's in full color or just the inks, but the bubbles and the narration, all of that is already on there. And then you go through and you see like, okay, does this dialogue still fit? Does this look too wordy? All of these things, because you're not done writing a comic until it's off to the printer. So in a perfect world, it would be that process. Sometimes I've had it where I don't see anything until it's time for the lettering pass. Or in the case of the Moon Girl and Double Dinosaur graphic novel, I haven't seen anything. In fact, I didn't even know who the artist was until I think the book what was like Publishers Weekly did like the announcement. I was like, oh wait, another Black woman. I was like, oh, that's fantastic. But I didn't know that until after the fact.
Oh wow.
And then we like met up and like talked and everything. But right, I still don't even know, I don't even know how the book looks outside of chapter one. So it'll be a surprise to you and also to me.
Is that a
wild? I'm excited.
Is that I'm not trying to set you up for the okie dokie.
No, it's fine.
Is that a you know, sometimes you'll work with a company that doesn't maybe know how to host their people that they hire, or is that more of a, it's, we're just waiting until the end secrecy type deal?
Marcus, to be honest, I'm not sure. It could be a mix of both. Sometimes because the editor really acts like the middleman, so to speak, I don't think it's ever really anything like a nefarious situation, but sometimes the way that, like, you know, graphic novel or comic creation is treated is kind of like a assembly line almost. That's what it feels like to me sometimes. So I think maybe that's the best way that they can keep things moving smoothly. I know for me, if I'm able to find out in any way who the artist is, the letterer or colorist, like, I'm finding them on social media and finding like their information and saying, hey, if anything in my script is unclear or you need more references or whatever, do not hesitate to email me, call me, whatever, because the editors are busy. Sometimes they're handling over 35 different stories at a time. And again, like, they're not trying to like be ill, you know, ill intent, but that's a lot of work for someone. Right. So if I can talk to whoever I'm working with directly, I prefer that. A lot of times in my scripts, I'll try to like put my information at the top. I don't know if it like gets erased or not, but I'm like, hey, note to whoever this artist is, hit me up.
Yeah.
Smart.
Yeah.
Yeah. That really is smart. That's smart. Yeah. Awesome. Thank you. That's what I was hoping for. These are great answers. So thank you. And I'm very excited for Moon Girl, because speaking of children's cartoons, my son Harrison discovered Moon Girl and Devil Dinosaur on Disney Plus.
Same with my kiddos. Yeah.
The next time I took him to your kids too. You can kind of claim claim Harrison a little bit.
I do.
He said it because what I was going to say to you all, because I was going to ask you for your, I was going to send you an email anyway, so I can send you all copies of Moon Girl and Devil Dinosaur, because I got a buttload of them coming. So I will make one out to Harrison, Brian. I will make one out for your kids. And Marcus, I will make it out to you as well.
Yeah, yes.
But yeah, he asked me after watching the show. We went to a comic book store. He's like, do they have any Moon Girl comics here? I was like, buddy, I don't know. Let's find out. And so I still read those couple pages to him every so often. So but this has been great. But y'all, we have a whole ass movie to get to.
Oh my god!
So we gotta strap on our deep sea drilling equipment and head to the Mariana Trench. To talk about a little movie called Underwater. Marcus, Brian, Steph, somebody want to try to do the barbershop summary for Underwater?
I picked it for this reason. Go ahead, Marcus.
Okay. All right.
Oh, man. So glad you're here, Steph.
What had happened was, there's this movie, right? And you got people, white people, in their underwear, underwater. They 70,000 leagues below the sea. And so they got these heavy, like, halo type suits on because they're drilling for something. And I never really caught what they were drilling for. But the scene kicks off with what's her name from Twilight? And Kristen Stewart. Yeah. And she did fantastic in it. She did great in this movie.
Yeah.
But Kristen Stewart is in this movie. She's brushing her teeth. Next thing you know, things get rocking. They get to shaking everything. They think they're under attack. They think they don't know if it's the pressure from the thing. They got to get it moving. There are 5 to 7 characters in here that it quickly deduces and reduces itself very, very fast. So they was like, yo, we got to get up out of here. People didn't die. The people above me, I was brushing my teeth, and the lady below me and above me had died. It's just a bunch of people that's dead. So they got to hop in these suits. They got to go, and they got to go trek to this escape pod or some type deal to get away from the area that they in, to get to a better area that has oxygen. So they got to hop in these suits. In order to get in the suits, they got to get buck naked. So then they get like, they got to get in their drawers. Then they got to slide in these big mechanic suits because the clothes don't fit inside the suit. Then they got, that part is not important, but I just thought it was very intriguing that they made a point to mention it in the movie. Yeah. So anyway, they go, they hop in this suit. Then they take this little elevator that takes them outside of the water. Really, they use these suits for like drilling just a little bit. So everybody terrified, everybody scared. There's a crack in one of the helmets, and the black man take the cracked helmet, He take the crack helmet. They try to get out of the thing at the water. All of the pressure just sucks him, and he gets like squished out of there like a tuna fish can. Like, I mean, they just squashed him
immediately.
Like, without hesitation, they make eye contact with each other, and she's like, "That brother is gone. He is like shloop, like gone." So he disappears into the thick of the night, and then they got to keep going and pushing through. But they are taking this journey in these suits across the sea base, like the sea floor,
yeah.
And they walk in, but they also trying to escape, like there's something that's attacking them. So they go and they find this fetus. They find him. So they go, that was the first thing I thought. They go and they find the fetus. It's on the table, and I'm like, the conservatives are not gonna like this because all lives matter. And so they go and they stab it, and they realize, what is this? It's a monster. But turns out it's a baby version of these bigger monsters that are underneath the sea. But these bigger monsters are just babies to the bigger monster that is hunting them. That is like this massive Cthulhu. So like they go through this whole thing, right? And they basically need to find protection, find a base, and try to figure out how to escape this monster underwater.
Excellent. Excellent. I mean,
nailed it, I would say. Right. You did a pretty good job.
I'll remember Cholula for quite a while.
I will also incredible. Remember
when I told you I was Googling that, that's how I pronounced it. The way that I spelled it wrong to Brian last night, and I out loud I said, "Yeah, Cholula," because I was using the voice to text. I said, "Cholula, Cholula."
I got that message too at like 10:30 p.m. and I was like, "Marcus, what are you?
Man? What are you, buddy?
What are you, man?" And I was like, "I think he meant like the Lovecraft monster." Uh-huh. Great, uh-huh. Cool. My algorithm not going to be messed up. Great, thanks. I can trust Marcus like that, Doug.
You know what?
You can't because you don't know what I'm going to send you, because it could be somebody who has a really gross collection of objects in his home.
All right, just move on.
So really quick, let's go over box office. Let's go over cast really quick. All right. And we'll get into this movie. So the budget. Now, it's important to note that all the research I did, it says that this is an estimated budget of $80 million. Now, Given the CGI, given the props, given all the water in this movie. Yep. I believe it. Like water, when 100%. It comes to production, water's expensive. And so I absolutely believe that. This movie did come out January 12th of 2020. So unfortunately, it is not subject to COVID issues because nothing was shut down at this point. And so the total money it made worldwide was $40,882,928. So a little over, just slightly half of what its budget was. That's the overall budget and stuff. Really small cast. I mean, Marcus is not wrong. It's like eight dudes. Yeah. And so it's like eight people. So Kristen Stewart plays Nora Price. Vincent Castle plays Captain Lucien. Mamadou Athey plays Rodrigo Nagata. TJ Miller plays Paul Abel. John Gallagher Jr. plays Liam Smith. Jessica Henwick plays Emily Havisham.
Colleen Wing.
I said, Brian, when she showed up, I was like, oh, hey, Colleen Wing.
I said the same thing.
Yep. All three of us did. Gunnar Wright plays Lee Miller. Fiona Ray plays Godmother. And then Amanda Troup plays Poseidon Patty. So, gentlemen.
I'm sorry. No, wait.
I didn't know.
Excuse me?
Those two are listed as credited. I don't know who exactly those are supposed to be.
Whose nickname was that?
Right
okay.
There.
Okay. Okay.
Oh, they used to call me back in my old days. Poseidon Patty was what they used to say.
That's a very specific nickname.
Okay.
I didn't even know Nora had a last name.
I didn't know any of these names. I'm not going to lie to you. I haven't seen any of these names.
And I've seen this movie a lot.
Really? Yes. I love it.
Yeah. It's a comfort movie for me.
Huh. I get it.
It falls into that gap of sci-fi that I could really, really love if we'll talk about it, but it falls in that little sweet spot for me. I'm like, it's not too long.
I mean, now's a great time. So, I mean, take it away, Steph. You picked this movie. Sure. You asked us to watch this. Thoughts on Underwater?
Yes. So Underwater is a gem to me, where it's one of those sci-fi movies where you could see where the vision was headed, even though it stumbled along the way. I really appreciated Kristen Stewart's, you know, acting.
Oh yeah,
skills in this, and like her as a character was very Ripley-esque, Sarah Connor-esque in a way. Yeah. I wouldn't put her up there with them, but like I can see again, like the vibe was there. Oh, yeah. Also, this movie kind of reminded me of Alien underwater. Not again. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Not because I thought it was as good as Alien, but it gave me those vibes and it felt like a fresh story in a way. Yes. I think this year Sea Fever came out. That was another movie I was going to have us talk about, but that's actually a very good sci-fi movie. Oh, but Sea Fever, check that out. Right. But this felt kind of, it felt fresh. Also, the Black person died very early on, so I didn't be stressed about that. And I can always appreciate that. Don't string me along thinking that the Black person is going to make it to the end. And you know that's not going to happen. So kudos to that. And then, you know, I don't know. The Cthulhu situation, that's always interesting. I like cosmic horror. That kind of made me think cosmic horror and sea. I can mess with that. And I just thought that the story, if it ever got a second chance for a sequel, like we can figure out all the questions that Marcus had and I had, like, what the hell are y'all doing down there anyway?
Yeah. Well,
just, let's figure that out.
I mean, we have a picture. Listeners, we have a picture of the alien fetus thing. It's right there.
It right up on the sky. All right, take it down, man. God, no. Sushi. I think this movie, I said a lot of the same things that Steph said to myself. And so number one, I was like, this is I asked the chat before, I was like, is this supposed to be a good movie or a bad movie before I even started it? He was like in the middle, and the reviews kind of say like it's split right down the middle. I think it's like five stars directly or whatever the middle is. And so one of the things I think it would have been better was more emphasis on the monster. That was the one thing that it was lacking. Was like, I said the same thing, Steph. I said, it feels like Prometheus, it feels like Alien, and it feels like a little bit of Predator a little bit, but just the way that it's shot and the darkness of the monster, there's like this, it feels like I'm in the sea. I can't see in front of me without the direct light in front of me. Like, I like the way they shot that. I wanted more attention to the monster a little bit.
That's fascinating to me because I loved how basically the entire movie. I enjoyed this movie, by the way, overall.
Yeah, me too.
And Steph, I'm glad you recommended it because I would have never watched this like just on my own. And I love the fact that basically they're just like literally wandering through the dark and they're like, I don't know, man, this, something's up. And then like just something skitters and they're like, what the hell is that? And you're just like, I don't know. Like, I mean, even Alien didn't show Alien until like the last quarter. And this movie basically does something similar. You see the shrimp fetus, whatever we're calling it. You see that. And Jessica Henwick pokes it. She pokes it, basically. Just love that scientist for her. But no, I like that. I like that we didn't know, because like it gives your imagination more time to build that up. And plus the underwater sea was already like an enemy in itself. Mm-hmm. Like it was like another adversary.
Good point, right?
So that like that worked, that part worked for me. And then at the end, you're just kind of like, what? Like there's, I mean, spoilers, I guess. I mean, we're getting into this is from 2020. I'm not too worried about it, but I mean, then you see this giant Godzilla thing and you're like, oh, damn. Okay, here we go. Like, let's kick out the jams.
That's down there, everybody.
I said, that little nail gun she got, that ain't gonna do shit to that.
No. Good luck, everybody. Not happening.
And in case you all haven't realized, and for those playing along at home, we do have a Pee-wee's Playhouse magic word where anytime anyone says the word fetus, this thing will just gonna pop up, and that's the way that this is gonna work. Brian, that's what's happening. That is what's happening. Yes, she did. I enjoyed this movie too. I thought it was a lot of fun. I got Abyss vibes, vibes, very much so, which I really, really enjoyed. I too really liked how it was just like it didn't really make you, it didn't burden itself with over explanation. Because I think there could have been a moment where They could have very easily made TJ Miller's character the like, well, I can tell you what this is.
I was so nervous for a second there. He was going to blow the hell out of me. As soon as I saw the ratted and tatted ass drawers he had on underneath that suit, I said, oh, it's going to be one of them movies. He's going to last the longest and annoy the hell out of
me.
His ass was gone too. I said, he's not playing no game.
This movie had vibes of like TJ Miller came to like the first day of filming and everyone's like, okay, like TJ Miller, we'll do this. And then like by like maybe like the end of the week, they're like, so we're gonna
actually there's a change in the script. We're actually gonna swap. I don't actually know how he died, actually.
He got eaten when they went through the underwater tunnel that was like the midway station, essentially, and then like the monster sucked him out of the suit. Oh, that was how I understood it.
It didn't seem delicious,
you know?
He got swallowed up.
The movie didn't seem too worried about how it happened, by the way.
You ever been swallowed?
Oh, Lord.
The Cthulhu was TD Jakes the whole time giving a sermon.
He had that long bishop robe on. Have you ever been swallowed up? You've just been swallowed. Whoa, freak, put the mic down.
I missed y'all so much.
It's a good prompt. It's a good prompt for a story. Yeah, I like it.
It is. Because here's the thing. When he started being like, well, it was the tectonic plates, I was like, oh, thank God. He's just an idiot. I was so relieved because I did not want to have to deal with him being like, well, you won't believe me, but aliens. Like, I just was not ready for that at all.
And I'm getting the vibe from the four of us that we're all like, okay, it's TJ Miller. We'll take it or leave it. Mm-hmm. But it very, like, I don't know. There were parts of the movie where I was just like, this is so out of place. Like, it just really felt like somebody wanted TJ Miller in this movie. And they're like, fine. Because you have Kristen Stewart, who's doing a great job, by the way. Like, she does a great job in this movie being like, I don't know how we make it, but we're going to try to do it. And then he's like, oh, yeah, because we're all sardines, right? Or something. Like silly, and you're just kind of like, it's weird. Kristen Stewart's character and his character exists like in the same movie. It's great. It's so funny to me.
Yeah, because there's very much moments where like, and I had this moment even a couple of times with her where there was some dialogue pieces where I was like, why was you're supposed to be the serious one? Please don't say that. Like she was like, I don't know. It's like loosey goosey, man. Like, or she'd say something like off like that. I'd be like, no, don't do that. Like, just be the strong female lead. Like, don't try to do it all. Like, I don't need, let TJ Miller do that. Like, like you. I don't like him. Like, so.
No, she was supposed to be like the little baby version of the lieutenant, right?
Yeah.
Like, very stoic and
I'm gonna be honest. When the movie was first recommended, didn't know anything about the movie, hadn't heard of it before. When I saw Kristen Stewart on the cover, Kristen Stewart is usually not my immediate go-to cup of tea.
No, I know.
And it has nothing to do with, like, I liked it. Twilight was fine. I have nothing against anything, but it's like when I see her, sometimes I'm like, I don't know what version of Kristen Stewart I'm going to get in this movie.
Great point. That's
you know what I mean? So it's like sometimes it feels like, okay, is she a stoner? Okay, is she like upset with the world? Like, I didn't know what I was going to get, but I did like what was presented in this movie, though.
Marcus, that is very fair because. Yeah, so when this movie came out, this is something that I would have seen in theory in the movie theater, but I didn't because of that reason. So when I finally watched it like deep into the pandemic, I was like, damn, I should have saw this in the theaters because I actually really love this movie. But it was because I didn't know which one we were going to get because Kristen Stewart and whatever that movie where she's working at the amusement park or whatever. Oh, I enjoy that movie. I like it. Which one was it called?
Is it Adventureland?
Adventureland. Yep. I actually really like Adventureland.
Yeah.
But I was like, good. I don't know if I want that Kristen Stewart in this movie. But we didn't necessarily get that. So I was like, you know what? Kristen Stewart, the sci-fi queen, the final, well, she isn't the final girl because she died. But anyway, I can take the...
Final Girl usually... I mean,
I don't know. I thought Slim Shady did all right.
Yeah.
I had, Marcus, I'm so glad you said that, because for the majority of this movie, I couldn't stop saying, like, God, she looks like Eminem. And then she kept, like, going through it, and I kept being like, oh, I just, Palms I don't know sweaty. If it was the hair. Palms I don't know spaghetti. What it was, but I kept looking at, like, this version of Eminem with the glasses on, and I was like, why does she look like that? I'd be like, she's doing a really good job. And then the next words were, too bad she looks like Eminem, though. Like, I just, like, I couldn't get past. I was ready for her to start dropping bars when she was, like, going down to the.
My name is.
You better lose yourself, okay?
Oh, yep. She was. God damn it, Brian.
Oh, my God. But that is so fair, Doug. And yeah. That's another reason why I enjoy this movie, because I'm just like, you better lean into it. The lesbianism of it all, Chris.
Oh yeah,
right.
Yeah. Uh huh.
Mm-hmm. Fooling, but I mean, but she did good. Like you need mm-hmm. a lead that can keep that. I think Kristen Stewart does really well at whatever tone she's gonna give you. It's like, so almost like this would sound like a knock, but it's not. Somebody who can be like, who talks to you in a monotone voice, you know that that's mm-hmm. gonna be like consistent through and through. Mm-hmm. It might be sometimes annoying to talk to this person, like, give me something else, like, give me a little bit of emotion, give me like an influx. I think Kristen Stewart, in anything I've seen her, is she gonna be consistent in whatever character you told her to play, she gonna be that through and through. There won't be any glimpses of anything else.
And mm-hmm. she did Spencer literally a year later. So, like, Spencer, which she was nominated for, like, she did a year later. So she did Underwater Alien, and then she's like, time to be Princess Di. Like, she's got, like, she's very talented.
The range is there.
It's there. Yeah. Like, yeah. I mean, so it totally fit.
She was Princess Diana?
Yeah. And Spencer, Spencer, I thought, and we talked about it back during that Oscar season, but I was like, this is it. Like, this is the movie to beat to me.
That range is crazy, because she almost just like it. What the hell?
Right?
It's kind of unsettling how similar she looks to Princess Diana.
Yeah, that motherfucker. That's crazy.
And then she did that. She did that rom-com after that too with Eugene Levy's kid.
She did.
Oh, she sure did. Yes.
That's right.
Happiest season. Yeah.
But the reason why I didn't like it, I didn't watch it, was because I didn't. Sorry, Kristen Stewart. I know you're an avid listener. I didn't think she could be funny.
You know, Jane
so
Gale
I just didn't watch it.
Wow.
Because she's typically like she's very deadpan. She and so and with Eugene Levy's son, whose name I can't remember, his like sarcastic humor isn't gonna work with someone who can only be like, "Oh, really? Tell me more." Like, it's just not gonna work for me.
She got a nice little collection of movies here, though. Like, I'm not mad at it. Like, I'm looking at her IMDb, and she's got like quite a few. Mm-hmm. Like, that's impressive.
Oh yeah. Yeah, I mean, there's totally a reason why probably like $10 million of the dollars of the budget went to Kristen Stewart because this movie, because they're like, can you just like, it's an alien movie, can you just play the whole thing straight and then we'll build everything else around you. We got Jessica Henwick, she is ready to freak out. Okay, she's ready to freak out for the whole movie.
She was at one point she was just freaking in, like, she was walking in a circle screaming.
That's right. Her character does walk in a circle.
She does. And I'm like, how are you not dead? But you, the guy whose rebreather broke and he like had, what was it like? What type of poisoning, whatever he had? I'm just like, y'all are not going to leave him. Like, he's just going to make it. He's going to make a full recovery. And he made it to the end.
That's crazy. Because I would have, when they started deciding who was going to go in the pod, his ass was going last. Because he multiple times he said, leave me. And at some point I would have been like, oh, only two pods is working? All right, brother, this is goodbye.
But then they all would have been dead because he would have never made it back to the chair. Because he, true. Yeah. That's true. So that's, I get it. The fumes got him.
The fumes did get him.
Oh,
he carried a moon pie for the whole back half of the movie. I'm not really sure if that ever came back. They was introducing concepts the whole time. That man grabbed a nail gun off the wall, and nobody else grabbed a nail gun off the wall. That man got a moon pie and then a bunny rabbit, and that was part of the end credit sequence. And I was like, listen, y'all introducing a bunch of random. I know we said trust the audience. Don't trust me that damn much. Nobody, she got a fat ass laser, a nuclear laser underwater. And nobody, and then the end credit scene in one of the newspaper clips, it said, and they decided to go right back to rebuilding of the drill underwater. And I said, motherfuckers, they nailed that shit. Because that's exactly what happened.
Oh, that's what people would do.
I need the sequel. I need this. It doesn't even have to, it could be like a Cloverfield situation where it's not even like a direct sequel. Like, I just want to know what the hell else is going on. The sea, the Mariana Trench, all of that is just very interesting to me. Because, like, what's down there? Mm-hmm. I don't want to actually know. I want to imagine what's down there. But, I think I did really like those end credit scenes. I like at the end of the movie where they're just giving you a little, I think for, what was it, a Brightburn? It is what it is, but I think I go up for Brightburn because at the very end they're showing you all of the evil Justice League, and I was like, okay, but like, where's that movie? That's what I actually
I wanted so much more of that because Brightburn was like, it was creepy, and I love the philosophy of the evil Superman, but when they introduced the Aquaman and the
like the War Witch for Wonder Woman.
That would have been a good movie. I would have loved it.
Whatever, was Batman actual bat?
I think he was a man bat or something like
Can't do man
bat. That intrigued me. It left me just enough to say,
right.
Forget everything else I just watched. Sure, it was fine. It was good enough.
What's this?
You got me here. But what is this?
That movie I'd like crazy. To see more. I did not review that. That movie was crazy.
I did feel that way at the end of this movie a little bit because it was like, well, they're going back down there. And I'm like, you're going back down there with underwater Godzilla? Mm-hmm. Like,
how are you doing that?
It's given Alien because what is Wayne Utani and like all the other, like they just keep doing Alien Romulus. We're gonna go, well, who knows what's going on there?
I thought that Cloverfield would. I was doing some Googling after the fact, and so I was like, is this connected to Cloverfield? I do like this idea of that secret monster that kind of came out of nowhere. Right. And then the Cloverfield 8 Mile movie, or whatever it was, with John Goodman in the damn tunnel.
It's the monster. It's
Eminem verse.
The monster's trying to break into the rap scene. Okay,
that's when he wrote Godzilla. He was thinking about himself as a monster who lived exclusively underwater.
I forgot. Let's move on. I forgot what I was called. That random ass picture of Eminem popping up.
Yep. There's another picture. I'm waiting for the other one. But
listeners.
Because then he said mom spaghetti.
She said it. She said it. Mom spaghetti.
Because I'm imagining there's some spaghetti floating in the water just past one camera pan. It's mom spaghetti. I'm hot and sweaty in the suit. I get it.
Yo, some of the found footage stuff that they did totally worked for me, by the way, because I was like, I can't see anything. I can't understand what even they're seeing, because like they started ratcheting up like when they first go on the underwater elevator. Listeners, if you haven't watched the movie, yes, there is an underwater elevator they have to go on to go deeper to get across the ground to get to the other escape pods. So I really hope you didn't watch this movie because that's an amazing sentence I said. Anyway, but like you don't know what you're seeing. Like for me, I didn't know what I was seeing, and I heard the music going up. I'm like, oh man, like a shark's gonna come, or like there's gonna be something. And then I was like, well, that's weird, that's blurry, and then it like attacked them or whatever, and I was like, oh, that was a thing. Okay. They needed HD, got it. I loved it. It totally worked.
The design of the little sperm babies was pretty good. You know what I mean? Like, I didn't say that. That's not
close enough.
So one of the scenes that I really like, I was texting a friend of mine, and she was like, what are you watching for the pod? And I was telling her I was watching Underwater, and she was like, what's it about? I was trying to explain it. So the scene when Kristen Stewart gets swallowed by the damn monster.
I thought
that was fly. The way that they shot it and the way she shot herself out of the monster and then ripped through it. I was like, hell yeah, you did that, until I found out that was only one of the massive bust that happened at the end of the woods. I can't explain it any other way. The monster's a freak. The damn things got released, and he then just, anyway. But yeah, Come on, somebody save me.
sitting it and enjoy it.
Look,
hold on, let me do it to you. You know what, my brother? That's on me. I shouldn't have asked you about this movie, my brother, because that's what you do to me all the time.
We have company.
Doug's got some animosity. We're gonna have to deal with this one.
There's gonna have to be a whole therapy.
March couldn't come quick enough for Doug Wagner, man. I tell you that.
That's not true at all.
You won all February. I mean,
oh, I was on his ass.
He was on my ass.
I was on his ass all February for no reason, but
which culminated with being called Great White Hope and a Gracious White in the same episode. I'm not gonna let it go.
He said Brian's white too, and he's full of hope. Why is that my nickname? I was like, I don't know, man. It's got a crooked crumbles, man. Anyway, I thought the design of the monsters was pretty fly.
Yes.
And the reveal that
it
was one of many. I think it adds to that thriller and terror of like, mm-hmm. Brian, you made a really good point about the water being another version of an enemy. And then to realize, like, you can't escape water. What I realize is I don't want to drown. If you're going to kill me, you're going to have to shoot me, put a bullet in my head. But do not try to drown me. That is a terrifying way to die.
Yeah.
Like, excruciating.
It's horrifying.
Then that on top of, like, an endless amount of monsters, like, when they had the nail gun, I was like, yes, that's right. Maybe you can take out, like, one or two. We don't really know how many it is.
Mm-hmm.
But to have this big reveal that it's one connected to a bigger monster, it was like, right. There's that sense of hopelessness that kind of comes of like, you can't beat this shit with just like a little nail ray gun. Like, that ain't gonna get it.
No.
And just like the endlessness of water too. So endlessness of that monster, and then like you're looking around and like, where does it end? That is freaking too. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Like, I was like, girl, you better nuke it.
I get it.
You can't get out of here, girl. No, she
went up and cranked that motherfucker up like she was at the studio. She went all turned on that boy. God damn, it need to be that much. Like, sheesh. Turn my headphones up.
And that's
that's my word.
And that's the difference between this movie and The Meg. Because The Meg, they talk about the Mariana Trench also,
right.
Except for they establish this weird like ozone layer that you can't go through.
Right. Did y'all see Meg 2?
No, we did not.
It's coming soon though.
Bring me on when you talk about that, because yes, just real quick. Because I saw I was gonna see it anyway. We were in Florida on vacation. My grandparents came with us. Nice. My son did not want to see it, so we were like, sorry, all the adults were going to see it. So he went to sleep. He said, well, whatever, I'm going to sleep. So he was knocked out. And we saw this movie, and what a disappointment. That whole Mariana Trench situation, like, you all built this up from the first movie. And then this is what you I want to talk about it. I have some grievances.
Making a note.
And so that's like, Brian, your point, because that was silly, like both in the
absurd.
The first one, they made it seem like everybody was just down there and it's well lit and like all of the lights, like it was like they had basically a lighthouse down there for that first movie. But this one did such a good job of like, nope. Like, this is dark and eerie, and you don't know what the lights are going to attract. And so I thought this ain't no Bahama water
like from a commercial. Like, it ain't all
clear
water.
No, the Meg 2s or the Meg period, their franchise, when they think of the Mariana Trench, is like sandals.
Yes.
Sandals!
Yes.
Welcome.
It's sandals. Yeah. This movie is like, no, it's Motel 6. We are not turning on the light.
There's a bullet hole in your sheets. Like, get used to it.
Why does the pool look like that? The pool boy's out. Well, when is he coming back? He's not. He's just out.
Just don't open the door after 10 p.m. Whatever you do, there's going to be a weird underwater monster. Just don't do it.
That water was murky and disgusting. They had that flashlight scene. It was like, I can't see anything in front of me. I was like, yeah, motherfucker, and I'm scared too. Like, why y'all take your asses out there?
Oh man. Well, and I appreciate it's something I appreciate about this movie. And like, again, I'm so glad you recommended it, Steph, because we've talked a lot about how we enjoy like the mid-tier, like action thriller, even rom-coms to a certain extent, of just like, you don't have to feel super invested, but it's like a step above. And this movie, it almost feels, it opens and it's just like, here's Kristen Stewart in her bra and she's brushing her teeth. There's some scary sounds. All right, we're on our way. Everything's exploding. And I appreciated that. Because it's
also
like,
a spider underwater.
Yeah.
Look, Doug, yeah. Look. Okay,
I had
she's
issues.
Trying to be
I,
nice.
I,
to
again,
creatures,
two things.
Okay?
Like, in the first 5 minutes, the movie took me a while. In the first 5 minutes, there were two things I couldn't get past. How the fuck did a spider get down there? That was the first question. And secondly is, why did they make her look like Eminem? Those are the two things I couldn't get past. Once I made it past this, this movie was very enjoyable.
You,
it just
you
took
got
me a
past
minute.
The underwater, like, the underwater super base. But,
Brent,
like,
people go underwater all the time.
Yeah, we just watched Power Rangers. That also had an underwater super base, too. So that was, like, that wasn't a surprise to me.
Brent, we watched grown men basically collapse themselves in a mobile toucan this summer. And so I believe the power of the human spirit wanting to go explore the ocean.
If you don't shut up, the power of the human spirit. One thing it was got. So when I started watching,
that happened.
Oh my God. I just remembered it until I started.
Okay, if we're being real, I thought about that during the movie, and I was like, I feel uncomfortable. So there. I get it. I get it. It still makes me feel uncomfy, but here we are.
Well, the way that when the black guy went out, there you go.
That man he got sucked out like a straw.
Yeah.
It's quick.
I mean, I feel like there's two things I always think about when I start watching these movies, like past the original stuff. I can't turn it off. So these are the two perspectives. My one is my black perspective, and then one is my fat perspective. Well, no fat people down here in this movie. If you fat, you can't survive this movie. That was the bottom line. Because them suits ain't got no elastic band. So if you can't fit in the suit and you the fat scientist, you fucked. So how do they pick people that are healthy enough to go down there? And then if you black, you also apparently fucked. Because why did he sacrifice himself for everybody else?
See, this is where, like, that type of the isms work in your favor, right? Because you would have been checking them in, just Henwick and all them in, like, well, I hope it was worth it.
Hey, brother,
I couldn't get down there.
Yeah, good luck down there, brother. Hey, good luck in that tube. Hey, man, put your fingerprint on that little piece of paper right there. I see you on the other side. Marcus, you're not coming. Nah, man. They said I couldn't fit in the suit.
No. They said I have to unload the crates up here. I'm not allowed to go down there.
They told me I can't go down, but maybe next year they told me lose 50 pounds and I could try out. That was the military. You can lose military, you can try out. So.
Oh my gosh, that's amazing. Because yeah, then that guy's just like, all right, well, I'm going back to the coast and drinking. Like, good luck down there.
TJ Miller is the biggest person in here, and obviously they portray him with them when they showed them ratted ass draws. I said, listen, this is a little bit too realistic because he ain't expect nobody to see his underwear.
He was crushed under rocks.
That's his fault.
I did think it was weird. It was a weird, if we could ever get the director on here, William Eubank.
Look, when I saw that motherfucker put a rabbit inside the little sling bag, I said, he's going to be the first to go. Because you have solidified an item that I have grown an attachment to that I think is cute. That's your fault. You did that. Nobody, Kristen Stewart ain't had no extra baggage. The old Captain Nemo didn't have no damn extra baggage. That motherfucker was disgruntled. And I couldn't tell if they was father and daughter. I'm not really sure what he cared about her significantly more than the rest.
It was like a pseudo, because his daughter was dead, we find out the whole entire time.
It's dead.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Got it. Missed that. Okay.
Yeah. I would want to know, William Eubank, we know you're an avid listener as the director of this movie, but I just want to know, like, why, like, everybody had to get into underwear and it was like never really fully explained and it's fine. I went with it. It's fine. But it just felt very like abrupt of like, all right, we got these mech suits. Strip. And it was like, okay, all right, that's what we do. That's what we do to get in the halo armor.
No underwater clothes. You made this fat ass quantum laser, but you couldn't make no type of clothing that is waterproof underneath. They got surf suits that are skin tight and latex. He said, "Nah, I need ass draws right now."
I feel like in the writer's room, he was like, "Okay, you know, an alien when Ripley has to get down to her drawers, we're gonna do that." But it's just
that's what it was.
Okay. And then the other thing is that someone in the writer's room went, "Well, isn't that just a little sexist to make her be the only one who has to do it?" Fair point. Make them all do it like that. That's how like, that happened.
That's what happened. Yeah. That's exactly, I agree.
They were like, "Well, we can't be discriminatory," and he's like, "Fuck." All right, fine, all of them.
All right, we're gonna see TJ Miller's ass. Let's go. Yep.
So obviously, I think Steph, you've alluded, there are a lot of similarities between this and Alien. I don't know. Have you seen any interviews or anything that said like that was a direct inspiration to this
movie? So no, I have not. But now you've got me thinking, because so I have not watched any like extra footage for Underwater, but now I'm about to add that to my YouTube search. Like, hey, let's do some background stuff. Hopefully there's something there, because it came out, even though it wasn't affected by the pandemic, like I wonder if all the other rollout was. So I hope there's information out there, because like it's given too much Alien vibe for it to have not been influenced by it at all. Like he would be lying if he said that it wasn't. Yeah. Then we'll have to fight.
And 100%. Like,
damn.
No, I have to fight. Because, like, what?
Like, what the fuck? Like,
oh, I'm immediately backing up Steph on this.
Oh, like, no, I'm absolutely. I'm with you. Like, the mech suits, the shots, the scenes, the way that it's shot, the cinematography of it all, the way that it looks like, yeah, I mean, he would be lying if he said he didn't watch this while he was writing.
It's like, he was like, you know what, guys? Man, like, this weed is really good, and I think I want to do Alien Underwater. And I would have been like, absolutely, let's do it.
Hell yeah.
I feel when people go more like ancient lore, they're on weed. But when you go cosmic entity scary monster, you got to go like a little vice above. Like, you might be a little bit
a little mushroom.
Yeah, mushroom. You got to be a little bit more elevated to be like, what if you want cosmic underwater? It's that's like, oh, true. Shit. Like,
yeah, that's more than like a gummy for fun at night. Yeah, like you're hitting something a bit harder. Yeah. Absolutely. 100%.
Yeah, I mean, looking at the chest bursters from Alien and looking at the fetus, those things are identical. Like save for a couple of extra
squiggly legs. Stop putting this shit
here
on the screen.
Except for some extra limbs.
I don't like the way it's looking at me. Turn that shit around. It's rolled over.
But I'm glad that brought it up. Because
you talked about the fetus, and it wants to know that it's happy you talked about him.
But look at this practical effect, though. Like, look at that.
That is a prop. And I would say, like, Google chest burster, and then look at this. And for listeners, Google, I think it was Underwater Alien, Underwater Movie. Alien, and then this eventually comes up, and they look really similar. Really, so like I think there's a lot of this that was inspired by certainly had to have been inspired by that for sure.
Yeah, like it would be criminal if it wasn't.
The placement of that monster too, I think, and the timing of it was also like really good, because it gave you just enough to kind of see, because they weren't directly showing what the monsters look like until like closer to the end. Having that little baby version of that pop up, to me, was like, that was just enough to hold me over. And then the glimpses of the monster. Now, when I saw the teeth and how big it could get to swallow her whole. Now, I wasn't really sure what. Now, this is where I wanted more of the monster. What was attracting the monsters? Was it pissed off? Was this a planned thing? Was it like chasing after the energy? Why did it? It seemed like it recognized Kristen Stewart specifically after she killed one of the little babies out of the he seemed like he had a personal vendetta, because they had locked eyes for a second there, and I was like, motherfucker, can you see me? Like, that would terrify me.
Because light that was attracting them, I think?
It's because he did say turn off the light at one point.
Then
heat, maybe, but then when they were walking...
Well, maybe it was heat, though, because of like when the reactor, like, she turned it all the way up, and like, it didn't scatter or anything, so... Heat, drill, light, something, some vibrations.
Yeah.
Low vibration.
He's just looking for some good vibes and a good time.
Yeah. I mean, it's lonely down there in the trench. It's
dark. It is. Yeah, true. I mean, you look like a use condom fish, so yeah.
I mean, I did appreciate this movie was like, look, we don't really fully know what's going on, even with the monster. Just man. Like, if there's a scary face, it's very wrinkly. Just go with it. Just go the little, with the used condom thing.
The little sonar. One, now, look, this was, I didn't want to say nothing about it, but now I'm going to say it. Listen, they showed that little sonar, what was seen out loud. I said, he just bust everywhere. I said, that shit is, I mean, it was like, not just one or two or five.
No, it it's was
the two little dots, the two little pods that went up, and then the amount of like kids that he released to go get the. I say, oh, he a vindictive motherfucker. He want to make sure he finished the job. He want both.
Oh of yeah,
them. Just let him go. What did they do? Like, what? Why don't? Could why do you have to finish. Catch those two spots? All right.
All right. Fetus.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Yeah. Okay. Okay, so I did a deep dive, and apparently I found an article from April 27th, 2020, on Bloody Disgusting. The director William Eubank took to Twitter, now called X. To say do it just to make you mad. He said that he posted a said like I'm gonna let the keen eyes find it, and it's like a shot of the captain wearing a like a basically like a seatbelt that was made by the Weyland Yutani Corp.
No,
that is the main corporation from Alien.
Okay.
Well,
I will post this went all the way up there for me now.
I will post a link to it in the episode description, but I found that. So yes.
Okay. Well,
there we have it. Well, now it Underwater has shot its way up.
Yeah.
There you go. Anything alien, I don't even that wretched number four. I will make arguments for it, and I'm not very happy about it. But yeah, I knew there had to be a connection because it was just doing too much alien. And for me to love that movie, because like y'all, I've seen this movie over 30 times. Like it's just one of those I just put it on, and I don't know if it's because it's filling the gap for the alien content that I haven't gotten recently. Because now we're finally getting Romulus. I've been reading the alien novels, and a lot of those novels are like just other things that's going on in the universe. And I just envision this movie as one of those random alien universe novels that I've read. And I'm like, oh, okay, well, they're doing stuff in the sea. So
there you go. Yeah. I mean, it's really easy to piece it together and get there.
Yeah.
I'm going to definitely revisit this movie sooner than later because I think, I'm not going to lie, the first 20 minutes I was on the phone and.
That's fair.
Couldn't get off the phone, and I felt like I missed. I was texting my friend, and I was like, I can't tell you what this is about. I feel like I missed some significant dialogue, but then maybe, I didn't. So
Go ahead.
No, I was gonna say, now that we know there's this alien connection, my brain went into like hyperdrive, and I found the photo, and like this is, I don't know if people can see it, but it's like right here. On his it's that belt buckle apparently.
Yeah,
so we can share the link in our episode description.
I will share the link in the episode description.
Tiny logo of Weyland Yutani on this like bombed out belt.
He does. He kind of looks like the fetus.
You do. I was thinking the same thing, Steph. He looked just like the fetus. Oh man, look
there it is. There it is. Yep, that's what you can come to this podcast for. When you join the live stream, you can see a picture of an alien fetus. That's why you join our Patreon, patreon.com/filmsinblackandwhite. Thought that was a good choice for the plug.
Films in black and white.
That's such clever marketing, Brian. Like, I'm really proud of you.
Yeah. Oh, no problem. Gotta get that Patreon in there somewhere.
Yeah, but
man, I'm gonna need a magnifying glass. Like, I have it on my second monitor, and I'm like, excuse me.
Listen, this part is there. I'll take it.
Oh my gosh.
Thank y'all for indulging me in this movie. It was either this or Life. And not Life with Martin Lawrence no, not that one, but the other Life. So there was a Life that came out in 2017. Oh,
that's exactly what this movie with Ryan Reynolds.
Yes. So
I love that movie actually.
Oh, Doug.
I do not know this movie.
Brian, that's ridiculous.
You I remember watching this movie.
You know what?
Marcus.
That's true. All right.
Book me. book me for whenever y'all watch this one, because that's another one that I think, Doug, you'll appreciate that one. They get into things a lot quicker, and it's another solid mid-tier sci-fi B movie. Awesome. Like, it's good. Yeah.
Yeah.
I just recently rewatched it.
Something about sci-fi B movies I can get on board with. A rom-com really has to do something special, like, for me. Like, so if it's right. My B tier for like fantasy, action, sci-fi, here for it. But if it's not A tier or rom-com, I'm not doing it.
That's fair.
Yeah, it's just who I am. Any other final thoughts on what did you say to me?
Said you B. Damn, he is aggressive. What is
happening? Yeah, that was very good.
What did you say to me?
That is from the movie Life.
It's
a really good. Let me tell you the connection to it. We got to bring Steph back for this movie. We got to watch that soon. It's such a good movie, and the way that it connects at the end, fire. Just fire.
I remember watching it, thinking it was like a Venom Spider-Man, pseudo, like backdoor pilot type movie. And I'm glad it wasn't, but like I had that in my head the whole time.
It was a little wonky in there for a second.
I'm glad I found out about it. Any other final thoughts on Underwater before we close things out?
If there is ever a Underwater graphic novelization that ends up happening, I would love to write that. So if that's ever a thing.
Let's manifest that. Please.
Look, I'm happy to ditto that. I will read that immediately because there's so many good concepts here that I would love to see teased out, and the visuals just and the story. There's so much there. There's so much.
I mean, I think with recent events, and I mean not to make light in all seriousness, and not to make light of human tragedy, but with that like thing blowing up in the middle of the ocean or imploding in the middle of the ocean. It wouldn't be hard for us to say to like write a sequel. Like, you know what I mean? Like you could modernize this and bring it up to speed and say it wasn't them. It was
XYZ.
Fetus.
Yeah. Sure. Oh yeah.
There
it is.
All right. Let's go. Let's just move on. Damn fetus.
Yep. Oh hey!
All right.
Magic word.
I'm gonna put this by it. This is gonna be films in white on white, and I'm gonna leave.
No.
Films with great white hopes.
Well,
plural. Close it out. Somebody close it.
I tried to. Does anybody else have anything that they'd like to plug?
The only other thing I want to say: play that game. Happy for us to watch that as well. Yes. I mean, we just did sci-fi. We just did sci-fi horror. I remember watching Two Can Play That Game.
College.
I
almost called Audible. Yeah, let's do that one next because Vivica A. Fox, like, wow. Yeah. Okay. But I do have something to plug, which I don't have. Forgot about this.
Please.
But I actually wrote a story in the Alien universe that will be out on March 13th. So next week. It's Alien Black, White and Blood, number 2. It's a cute little short story, but it was my first foray into a universe that I'm clearly obnoxiously obsessed with. But yes, that finally happened.
That's sweet. No, that's awesome. I'm excited. We'll have to check that out.
Yes. All right, March 13th.
Brian, Marcus?
This cover is fire. Oh my God. This is fantastic. Keep walking around me. I'm going to upload the cover.
Okay, that's fine. Okay. I love those black, white, and blood storylines too. So Brian, what do you have to plug?
I'm just here to plug, like I do every week, my wife's Etsy shop, Color Me Confetti, all one word. Just go to Etsy.com, put in Color Me Confetti for all of your printable party needs. You don't have to leave the house. You got to plan a party. Just go there. Print out some stuff. It's super easy. You don't have to go to Party City. You don't have to go to Target. You don't have to do anything. You just print it out at home. It's great. Color Me Confetti on Etsy.
Absolutely.
Shout out to Maggie Roush. Happy birthday to Maggie Roush. Happy birthday to my dog, even though he on my ass. Happy birthday to Doug. You know what I mean? Past birthday to Doug. Happy past birthday to Maggie. Happy future birthday to Brian as well. That's, that's coming up. Yeah, it's just, Friday, my deal with birthdays.
I'm happy to be here.
That's right.
Wow.
Ooh,
all right.
Sweet. That's the one I found. So,
ooh, that's awesome.
I think that's the cover.
Yeah, that's probably the first one, but the second one looks very similar. So, same vibe.
All right.
Marcus. Yes, it is your turn.
All right. Make sure you follow the mantra, never offended, always humble, or Noah for short, N-O-A-H. Live the mantra, follow the mantra, go buy yourself some gear. There's a link in our bio. We're working on some pricing right now, so we can bring that price down so we can have you wear the mantra at an affordable entry price, all right? But whatever you do, follow the mantra, never offended, always humble. Go stream some music. You can stream Marcus Destin. I'm writing some new music, writing a new project right now as we speak. You can also go listen to Soul Tie, S-O-U-L-T-Y-E. But whatever you do, live the mantra, listen to the mantra, follow the mantra, never offended, always humble.
Absolutely. Hey, if you enjoyed our conversation with Steph and you want to hear more of our conversations about different things, Marcus, are you bopping to music that you think is playing?
No, I'm just okay.
I was making sure because context, last week Marcus was like thought he played music, and I vowed to not have that happen again. And he was like, "Can y'all not hear that?" We're like, "We didn't hear shit, man." Like,
I'm mad too because it was that duffel bag boy. I don't do nothing. I'm a ball down all day like a clock on the wall.
So yeah, I wanted to make sure we didn't have a missed opportunity. Hey, if you enjoyed our conversation,
ain't about to pick the day to start running. Woo!
Close this out, Doug.
Yeah, I'm on your ass. You gonna get it these last 2 minutes because you got me this okay. whole pod.
Yeah, ahead. You're gonna. So this next 2 minutes will be 20 minutes. Thanks to Marcus. So. Recommend this to a friend or a family member. Best way to get the podcast some traction. Also, go up to patreon.com/filmsinblackandwhite. Sign up for one of our tiers there. Help us make this thing happen on a weekly basis. But more importantly, like I said, share us, friend, family member. Best way to spread the love. Brian, we have a 3-step process to success. What is that first step, sir?
Hey, folks. I'm here to tell you to read a book. Steph listed all the amazing things that she has written. I don't need to go much into more detail here. Go read the stuff she's written. They're good stories. Mm-hmm. Go read a book.
Please, any book. Marcus, do you want to do step two?
That's fine. Okay. Make sure two of us are hitting buttons at the same time.
Please. Mm-hmm. We are a class act.
Drink some water. You know what I mean? The sun is coming out apparently in South Dakota. Maybe we skip winter. Maybe I just drink myself. Who really knows? But the sun is coming out. Treat yourself to some nice water. Steph is drinking water right now. Don't just go get some meal. Sometimes you just need straight water. Like, you don't need to cover it in any flavor. Sometimes your body is just dying for just straight water. So give yourself some water. Put a little lemon in it or something like that. Treat yourself to the nice stuff. But whatever you do, drink some water.
Absolutely. Hey, you don't want to have ratty drawers like TJ Miller? Wash your ass. It's important to do that. Take care of it. Again, you're going to start putting on shorts and going out into the environment in springtime, and you're going to go out there with a musty ass. That's a mistake for you, and it's a mistake for all of us to have to experience it. So just please, it's important to take care of that.
And now Sea Monster has the scent of your ass and them ratted and tatted ass drawers forever. Now you got to live with that.
Forever, ever? That's the way it works.
Smell like a Cthulhu.
That's right.
Cholula.
Cholula. That does it for this week's episode of Films in Black and White. Big thanks to Stephanie Williams for joining us this week.
Yes.
So excited you were here. Happy to have you on again. We got some stuff we got to watch, y'all, in between now and next time, which we're very excited about.
We got some exciting stuff.
We'll be back next week with another fantastic episode. But in the meantime and in the between time, stay safe, stay healthy. We love y'all. We appreciate y'all. We'll catch y'all next week.
Bye.
Oh, we do it. Tell them, shout it. So get. Tell them, we. Get low. Yeah.